John Murray Press presents Opportunity, Seize the Day, Win at Life. Written and read by Rob Moore. Preface. My dad has always been my hero. Growing up, I looked up to him, especially when it came to entrepreneurship, sports, and being a strong person. I've never met anyone who can turn around a business quite like my dad could. He could take a derelict building and turn it into a hotel. He could take the most run-down pub and turn it into a thriving restaurant. He could hustle before social media even knew what that word meant. He would go to auctions and liquidation sales and buy cheap stock for pennies in the pound for his leisure businesses. He'd negotiate hard. It was a game to him. He'd always pay in cash with the big brown £10 notes folded in half, all the Queen's heads facing the same way and always in his right-hand back pocket. My eyes would pop out of their sockets whenever he pulled out his big wad of notes. It seemed that nothing embarrassed him. Whatever he wanted, he'd ask for it and he'd usually get it. He loves to tell me how he punched way above his weight in marrying my mum, nearly 12 years his junior. Later, when his bipolar disorder got worse, he never lost his charm and persuasive character. When he was locked away in the high security Ward 5 of Peterborough Hospital, where you need special keys to get through at least four separate doors, he would call my employees and persuade them to come through the first door, then persuade the receptionist to let them through the second door and the third doors. Then he'd get the nurses to let him out of the fourth door, and out he'd walk with a cigarette hanging off his bottom lip and his trousers hoisted up under his armpits. He once persuaded one of my employees that he needed a ladder for a project he was doing in hospital. He got them to bring it in through all the security doors. This is an extendable ladder. And then he used it to climb over the 12-foot perimeter fence. He revelled in the delight of attaining his freedom and loved to tell you just how cunning he'd been. At the height of his illness, he once got himself arrested for stealing thousands of pounds worth of DIY equipment from Homebase. He loaded up a pallet trolley with an outback barbecue, a gas heater, and the largest items he could find, and walked right out of the store in broad daylight. Once out and around the corner, he turned back, pulled up his trousers and told the security guard, "I've just nicked a grand's worth of stock and you're shit at your job." He seemed to have a great sense of pride about the whole thing as he V-signed the store security officer from the back of the police van. When my dad is on his emotional highs, he can talk himself into any business building, past any gatekeeper, and in front of any business owner or multimillionaire. He'd pitch crazy, ridiculous inventions and get people to believe in them. He's raised money for hotels, pubs, cars, horses, bets, properties, crazy inventions drawn like my five-year-old daughter might. Even my school fees as a kid growing up, you name it, he's begged for it, borrowed it, and most often outright blagged it. He's never had any money to start any of his ventures, so he's always created everything from nothing, forging opportunities out of nowhere. He rarely shielded me from any of his ventures or misdemeanors. He took me with him on whatever crazy journey he could, letting me see the ebbs and flows, the highs and the lows. He moved us around East Anglia and Cambridgeshire in the UK many times as he took new opportunities and repeatedly started a new life. I lived in pubs and hotels and big houses and small flats. We all knew as a family that if things got hard, Dad would get us out of trouble. And we all subscribed to a crazy, exciting lifestyle. He's head-butted and broken a policeman's nose for having a go at Ian Botham. He's blown up a man's car for sleeping with his first wife while he was stationed abroad with the RAF. He's scared stupid an endless string of boys and men who've gone within 15 miles of my sister. At 60 years old, he was still getting into fights in the pubs he was taking over and renovating. Everyone was equally scared and full of respect for my dad. They loved him as much as they feared him. No one more so than me. When he was growing up, my dad had a hard life. He was raised in Uddersfield, a northern English town in relative poverty. His mum died when he was 2. His dad never showed any affection towards him and remarried someone just so they could raise his kids because he couldn't cope alone. He died when my dad was 18. Dad also lost his sister, a mother figure to him, which I think hit him really hard. Because of this hard upbringing, Dad didn't find it hard to take chances, forge opportunities, and make things happen. After all, when you've experienced what he has, what's the worst that can happen when you try for or ask for something? My dad has made and lost millions over the years. He's had successful pubs, hotels, bars and restaurants, and he's owned lots of real estate. A lot of my dad's customers in the early years were American servicemen on the local US base, and he made some really good friends. Then the Gulf War happened and the US bases in the UK emptied almost overnight, and my dad's hotels, pubs and friends followed suit. He lost everything, but he managed to scrape together enough money to start a small restaurant, which he turned around from a dump into a thriving carvery restaurant. This time it was 2 years worth of roadworks that killed my dad's trade. And once again, he scraped together just enough money for a very run-down, dirty pub in Peterborough called the Royal Arms. He rolled up his sleeve, cracked his knuckles, bought a massive long-haired Alsatian called Bruno, and systematically banned every single person from that pub within the space of just a few weeks. I saw him break pool cues by hitting people with them, rugby tackling drunks, punching, kicking and headbutting people. Bear in mind, my dad was nearly 60 at this point. It was him and the dog against a pub full of reprobates. Within a few months, he'd established a new carvery restaurant and a thriving trade. It had become a family business, and my dad was proud that we were all working together. He ran the pub and carved the meat. My mum was the chef, cooking for more than 100 people a day. My sister ran the restaurant, and I ran the bar. It all looked rosy at first glance, but it was hard. My parents had no savings, no pension, and no retirement plan, but the pub trade was all they knew, so they had to keep going. I was 25 at the time, living with them in the small flat above the pub. They seemed to age much quicker the longer they were in the dying pub trade. Then on December the 15th, 2005, at around 1 o'clock in the afternoon, in a packed pub full of his best customers and many of his only friends, my dad's life took another huge turn. Picture this, a freezing winter's day. My dad, like a DNA fusion of Basil Fawlty from Fawlty Towers, charming, angry, erratic, and Victor Meldrew from One Foot in the Grave, happy in his misery and letting everyone know about it. Wielding the carving knife and silently daring people to ask for an extra slice of meat. The pub was heaving, everyone wanting to eat at 1 o'clock, which really used to annoy my dad because he could only use the table once that day. He was in full stress mode. Nothing new so far. But then he just stopped. He stared into space. He stopped and went vacant long enough that it became awkward. The customers queuing up were looking at each other. I was looking at my sister. It was like the music in the pub had stopped, and the scene was on pause. He then started muttering to himself, then shouting aimlessly, then screaming, then wailing and squealing aggressively. He still had the long, sharp carving knife in his hand, and the whole pub was frozen and on edge, like a scene in a Western bar before a shootout. Dad was clearly very distressed, so I tried to talk to him. I looked him square in the face, but he couldn't see or hear me. I managed to drag him through the bar, away from the customers, out to the front of the pub. Not easy, as my dad was 17 stone back then, and most of that was in his beer belly. I shook him. I shouted at him. I slapped him in the face. Nothing. By that time, many of the customers had congregated around the front bay window to watch the drama unfold, and my mum and sister ran out to try and help my dad. Within minutes, a reinforced police van pulled up. Two policemen got out, and one, who looked no older than 19 years of age, pulled out a baton from his belt, and he beat my dad around his back and legs until he collapsed to the floor. They both piled on top of him and wrestled him onto his front, strapped him up, bundled him into the back of the van, and took him away from us. He was later sectioned. I wasn't allowed to see my dad for many weeks, as he was in a high security ward for the mentally ill. This was our first experience of my dad's bipolar disorder, and we had no idea what we were in for. Oh, and did I mention it was his birthday? What a present. I will remember December the 15th forever for the wrong reasons. My dad worked hard his whole life, and he made huge sacrifices to give me and my sister a good life. One he'd not had himself. He took us on holidays he couldn't really afford. He bought me all the best sports equipment to give me a chance at being good at something, cricket or rugby or golf. He struggled financially to put me through private school. He bought me my first car. He put a deposit down for my first house. Yet in that moment, all the thanks he had for his hard work was public humiliation and mental illness. It was the worst day of my life, too. I can't begin to tell you the humiliation, guilt, and shame that I felt while it was all happening, and for a long time afterwards. I felt very responsible for what had happened. Many people have told me, Rob, it's not your fault. But I believe that part of what broke my dad down was the endless pressure turned to stress and the dependence I had on my dad. I was 25, but still fully reliant on my parents for everything. I was like a baby chick sitting in the nest, mouth open, chirping away, begging for food. Selfish, feed me, feed me, feed me. I'd made absolutely nothing worthy of my life, despite having all the chances, the support, and some talents. I was good at most sports, I got A grades, I was top of the year in art. I could turn my hand to many things, but I was good at nothing, especially standing on my own 2 feet. Sad but true. My life was going nowhere and I knew it, but I was stuck. I was dependent, I was reliant. I was powerless because I didn't know how to change or improve my life. It meant starting again. It meant going out on my own. It meant fear. It meant rejection. And I had the comfort of falling back on what my parents had built for me. But this was a false safety blanket. It was like a cot for a 25-year-old baby. But looking back, December the 15th, 2005, was also the best day of my life. The single turning point. The fork in the road, the start of my new life. It was like I'd had no opportunities in the 25 years preceding this day. At least, that's how the victim mentality I had at the time perceived it. What I couldn't see then, but is really clear to me now, is that it was the greatest opportunity of my life, presented to me in the disguise of pain. My shame eventually turned into motivation, or rather desperation, and I started searching for something. I started tentatively at first, but I soon built up momentum and my search became breathless and relentless. I had no real clue what I was looking for, but I needed something now. Anything. There was no other option. I had no choice. The one independent, responsible move I had made up to this point was working part-time as an artist. I worked weekends and night shifts at the pub, and I painted during the day and late through the night. Art was something I was good at, and it seemed that the more screwed up your art was, the better it would sell. I was pretty screwed up, so I reckoned I was onto something. However, I didn't have much success selling my art because I was an artist and not a salesperson. I rarely ventured out of Peterborough. In fact, I rarely ventured out of my house. And so my art got darker and darker and more insular the more I distanced myself from people and places. A rare venture out for me was to Cowgate, a semi-boutique-y street in Peterborough where a new, privately owned interior design and furniture shop had opened called Elements. It was minimalistic and high-end, and it was recently opened. The walls were bare. The owner, Mike Wildman, was friendly, and in a rare moment of courage, or maybe opportunity, I asked him if he wanted to see any of my work. To my surprise, he agreed, and the next day I took my portfolio in to show him. I think some of my work raised his eyebrows. Dark is an understatement. I used to paint to heavy metal, or Radiohead for a bit of light relief, so you can imagine what my art was like. Mike sifted through my work and picked a few pieces out. He offered to hang them in his studio on a sale or a return basis. I was stunned and nervously excited. I'd never had any of my art exhibited anywhere before or ever seen in public. Could this be the start of a real career for me as an artist? Well, as it turns out, no. But I never could have imagined where it was going to lead to. Mike played a big part in the change of the direction of my life, and I'm eternally grateful to him for believing in me when I didn't believe in myself. Over the next few years, I sold a few paintings through Elements, enough to just scrape by for a while. The brightest moments of my short art career were the calls from Mike. He'd always call me personally to tell me when a piece of my art had been sold. He would tell me about the buyer, and he'd pay me right away 60% of the sale. I would ride my bike to Cowgate, go in, and he'd hand me a cheque with a handwritten note. This was all great, but it was actually just the start of the journey. Maybe even a distraction. The real opportunity was hidden in plain sight. Mike had been investing in property on the side while he was setting up his shop. This was 2003 to 2005, so the UK property market was buoyant, and it seemed like anyone could get into property and it would keep going up forever. For at least a year, he'd been suggesting, nudging, and then nagging me to go to a local property meeting. To get into property. To invest. What do I know about property? I'm an artist, I would say. I don't have any money anyway. The truth was, I was scared. Scared of anything new. Out of my little comfort blanket of security, which was ironic as I was far from comfortable, and I had a political rage against the machine hatred of corporate and commercial yuppies. Fuck you, I won't do what you tell me. So I kept politely declining, staying in my little bubble of quiet desperation. All that changed on December the 15th. I still felt scared, lonely, insignificant and useless, but my attitude towards putting myself out there was totally different. I said, fuck it, I'll go to that property meeting. I'll see what all the fuss is about. Meeting the opportunity. It had been about a week since my dad's episode, and there was a monthly property meeting being held at the Holiday Inn. I was going, and I was scared. I got some cheap business cards printed with the grandiose title of Artist and Investor, and I rode my bike there in the freezing cold. There were a dozen or so people there, but I managed to sit on my own for most of the event at the back of the room to avoid talking to anyone. I felt like a fraud and knew nothing about property. But Mike was in my head, nagging me. Rob, don't just go there and sit at the back on your own the whole night. Just as I was heading out of the door inconspicuously after the talk, something stopped me and I turned right into the bar instead. I'll stay for a bit. I'll see what this is all about. Looking back, I can see that my first attempt at networking was a cringe fest. No eye contact, nervous handshakes, cheap business cards thrust around the place or hidden behind as an excuse to exit the conversation. I got through everyone pretty quickly, leaving one last person sat at the bar on his own. I sat down and looked at him a couple of times, but he was just staring straight ahead, looking at the spirits hanging on the wall. We sat there in a long, awkward silence, well, for me. I'd racked up nearly £50,000 of consumer debt by this stage in my life, and even buying a couple of drinks was a struggle. But I couldn't bear the silence anymore, so I leaned closer to him. "Do you want a drink?" I said. "Diet Coke," he said, completely deadpan, without even turning his head to look at me. So I bought the grumpy bugger a Diet Coke, slid it over to him, and reached out my hand. "Hi, I'm Rob." Staring straight into my eyes, without even a hint of a smile, he replied, "I'm Mark Homer. Good to meet you." He shook my hand so hard it made my whole body pop. We exchanged pleasantries. I spouted a few property-related words to make it look like I knew what I was talking about. We exchanged business cards and we went about our respective lives. Or so we thought. I was a bit despondent when Mike asked me how it had all gone. I didn't feel like I'd gained anything from the event. I felt out of my depth. He sat me down and explained that networking takes time, that you can't just expect the people and the money to flock to you on day one, that the important part is the follow-up. And that was terrifying for me. What would I say? But following Mike's advice, I held my breath, got out the small pile of business cards I collected, and I emailed every single person to say that it was nice to meet them, and to ask if there was anything I could help them with, even though there was nothing I could help them with. I can't remember exactly who replied, but the reply that interested me the most was the one from Mark Homer. He invited me to his office to meet his boss, who owned a property sourcing company. He also suggested three books that were really good for property investing and personal development, a term I'd never heard before. This presented me with a quandary. I was hungry, motivated, and desperate, and I really wanted to make a change, but I hated reading books. In fact, the last book I'd read cover to cover, perhaps the only book I've read cover to cover, was Roald Dahl's Fantastic Mr. Fox, and I was probably 9 years old. Sure, it's a great book, but not great for preparation for a meeting with two property tycoons. I wanted to impress these guys, so despite my painfully slow reading pace, I bought the books and I got stuck in. I can't tell you why or even how I read them all that week. It took me hours and hours. I'm one of those people who reads by saying the words aloud in my head. But I got through them all just in time for the meeting. And to my surprise, I really enjoyed them. I walked with a little more swagger into the small but fancy new office, knowing I'd done my homework. Mark met me at reception, and right away he asked me about the books. I could recall a decent amount of the content. I spat out a few fancy words to impress Mark, like assets versus liabilities, yield, doodads, masterminds, and we engaged in one of the most stimulating conversations I'd had in my life. I didn't know this at the time, but this was one of Mark's little tricks. He would recommend books to people as a kind of test to see if they actually read them, to see if they actually followed through. Years later, he told me that I was the only person he'd ever met who read all three books before meeting him again. The meeting went well. We got on and I felt like I'd impressed them. Their outfit looked slick. They looked successful, rich. It was a real business with multiple income streams and opportunities, and I wanted a piece of it. I left the meeting on a high, but then my imposter syndrome kicked in, my victim mentality kicked in, and my chronically low self-esteem kicked in. What would these guys see in me? I had no experience, no money. I was in debt. I was a struggling artist. Why would they be interested in me? I stewed on this for a while, did the usual process of beating myself up, but then had a brainwave. What if I offered to work for free? I could do a few shifts at my dad's pub, I could work weekends for these property guys, and I could paint late at night, which I was already doing. So I followed up again, and we arranged another meeting at their offices. Just as I was getting ready to give them my great idea, Mark said, "We would like to offer you a job here. We can't pay much in salary, but we can pay generous commissions for properties sold to investors." I tried my best to hide my shock, awe, and excitement, probably not very well, and I accepted the job on the spot. I knew what I wanted, and I'd have worked for free anyway, so any money was a bonus. I was wildly excited about all the new opportunities headed my way, but then it hit me again. Bang! I don't know anything about property. I've never sold anything in my life. I hate selling. Why would anyone buy from me? I'm just a skint artist. The result. Here's the radio edit short version of the next 15 years. I worked at that property company for just under a year, clearing my debt of £50,000 and making just short of a six-figure net income. Mark and I forged a fantastic friendship that's still going strong to this day, and a business partnership that's stronger than ever. One of the proudest moments of my life was being best man at Mark's wedding, and he was also best man at my wedding. We bought almost 20 properties together on the side in that first year in 2006 while working for the property sourcing company. Mark and I owned them jointly, 50-50, and he and his mum and stepdad put up all the money. We set up our own deal sourcing property company, which had a turnover of many millions of pounds. We then pivoted that business into property training, and we've generated well in excess of £100 million of revenue since then. We've built the UK's largest property training company. We continued to build our own property portfolio, buying hundreds of rental units, virtually all with none of my own money, most of which we still own and get recurring income from to this day. Our property portfolio grew to such a size that we needed our own lettings agency, which now manages nearly 1,000 rental units and is likely to become the biggest letting agency in our city. As our property training business and our brands grew, we attracted attention from other companies and bought a personal development training company for a tiny amount of money in a rescue package. We turned that business around to be a multi-million pound, eight-figure company, which is still thriving today. We currently employ approaching 100 people in three of our companies and almost another 100 contractors in our property business. We have almost the same again in outsourcers and suppliers and contractors around the UK. We won Business of the Year 2016 and Property Training Company of the Year in 2017. I retired financially in my late 20s and became a millionaire before the age of 31. I tried my hand at retiring a good few times, but I just couldn't stick it, and it rarely lasted more than a few weeks. Just long enough to get itchy feet again. The more opportunities that came my way, the more I seemed to want to grab them all. I'd spent 25 years taking hardly any, so I guess I was making up for lost time. I also started to enjoy greater and greater challenges, so when opportunities for public speaking came along, I grabbed them. I was both terrified and terrible at first, for many, many speeches, but I eventually broke 3 longest speech marathon world records. The individual speaking world record of 47 plus hours and the team speaking world record of over 120 hours, which we broke twice. I've written approaching 20 books, some in partnership with my business partners and many others under my own name. Many of my books have become number one bestsellers across all book categories. I am told my book Money was one of the top selling finance business books of 2018 to 2020 in the UK. I'm published by Hachette, the second largest global publisher behind Penguin, and they've been fantastic to work with. I could never have predicted some of the things that have happened. My podcast, The Disruptive Entrepreneur, has had millions of downloads and subscribers in more than 200 countries, even Myanmar and Vatican City. I wonder if the Pope listens. Better still, I've been fortunate to interview, meet and become friends with many of the most successful and famous people in the world, including celebrities, amazing sports people, billionaires and the world's greatest achievers. I still pinch myself that such amazing and inspiring people view me with enough credibility to allow me into their lives, and I often feel slightly unworthy of their friendship. Through all of this, my social media presence has compounded. I was one of the very first UK influencers to get Facebook supporter program status. Thousands of people now subscribe to my exclusive content. And then I was one of the first 20 people in the world to get Facebook stars and then Facebook paid live events. And I was one of the very first to get the LinkedIn live video feature. I'm also one of the top followed people on Clubhouse in the world. My property portfolio has given me time and financial freedom to travel the world, and it's enabled my young son to play in various British, European, and World Golf Championships. Possibly my greatest and proudest achievements, and these aren't actually mine, are the 8 hole-in-ones, or aces, my son has hit by the age of 8. His first was when he was 3, and he's unofficially the youngest ever golfer to hit a hole-in-one, and his 7th and 8th were a week apart. Reading this does make me feel a little uneasy. It's uncomfortable to brag, or humble brag, about my external achievements. But one of my mentors said to me, "Rob, facts are facts, they are not brags." All of these came about because I simply opened myself to new opportunities. Right now we're merging all of our companies into one brand, Progressive, and taking our events to a global audience. We're likely to go from 850 live training days and events a year to many thousands, serving greater numbers of people across the globe. We're also developing almost 150 units in our commercial to residential property portfolio and acquiring some companies to build our business portfolio, increase our reach, and diversify our risk. In the early years, I'll admit that money was important to me. Paradoxically, the more I've made, the less important it's become. Helping others, doing meaningful work, and making a difference has far overtaken money. Now, don't get me wrong, I still enjoy money, but I've got a greater sense of fulfillment and privilege from setting up the Rob Moore Foundation to help young and underprivileged people start meaningful businesses to change the world. Mike gave me a shot. He believed in me as an artist, and I want to be that person for many other young, aspiring, budding entrepreneurs across the globe. One single moment, disguised as the worst of your life, can turn out to create not just one opportunity, but every single opportunity for all the great things in your life now and forever after. That is the power of opportunity. Despite the thousands of opportunities I missed, ignored, rejected, or had been totally oblivious to, the next day, the next moment, the next nanosecond, another one always presents itself. I know this now, but I couldn't see it at the time. I was stuck, blinkered, consumed by my own self-pity, walking around in a trance, blind and bitter. Once you get your head out of your arse, where it's very dark and all you can see is shit, and start looking around you, in front of you, and what's inside of you, it's amazing what you see. Then you realise it's been there all along. How were you so oblivious for so long? Seize the day. I believe you win at life one day at a time. You positively dictate your future by owning your present. And the present is today, now. All success is created today, now. Seize today. Seize this moment, now. There is no tomorrow. No matter how hard things are today, you always have tomorrow to start again, to seize the day again, to win at life. You get way more attempts at success than you think, way more opportunities to win, way more chances to try. All you have to do is to get through the day to be able to seize today, every day. Winning at life is all about taking opportunities and making decisions. Opportunities do not come once a month or once a week or even once a day. They come every second, every nanosecond. They're infinite and limitless. So be aware of the infinite opportunities around you. Spot and then evaluate the ones that are right for you. Seize them today and every other day to win at life. This is not an other personal development or mindset book. In fact, I wrestled pretty hard with my publisher, who I love dearly, to ensure I didn't just write another mindset book, despite their desire for me to write a mindset book. I hope they don't edit this bit out because it's important. I wanted to write something different, something more unique, venturing into an area other authors have not explored. So there'll be no swear words in the title, no subtle or magic art, and I'm not an ex-military SEAL or SAS superhuman psycho. If you search opportunity on Amazon or Audible, you'll find virtually nothing. Yet to me, that's exactly what life is all about. Success, progress, growth, happiness, fulfillment. It's all about spotting and taking opportunities. I want to thank my amazing business partner and best friend, Mark Homer. We both saw an opportunity hidden in plain sight that we both needed at the time, but we didn't know we did. We're 15 years into a partnership and still going and growing strong. We took a chance on each other. There was no proof. It was a risk. We could have failed. Even to this day, we've both experienced hard times and challenges that have threatened our partnership, but we're still growing and supporting each other. I'll share the full story later in the book, as I believe it can really help you on your own journey of seizing opportunities. Our partnership not only ranks up there in the best decisions of my life, but it spawned hundreds of subsequent knock-on opportunities that have totally transformed my life in virtually all areas: health, wealth, growth, and happiness. Who'd have thought such a grumpy old bastard could make such a profound difference to my life? Introduction. What is opportunity? Opportunity can take many forms. Think about the last time you had an opportunity. How do you know it was an opportunity? What made it an opportunity for you? Opportunity, noun, a time or set of circumstances that makes it possible to do or achieve something. Opportunity is many things to many people. It's a favourable or appropriate time, occasion, or moment. It's the apparent right set of circumstances. It occurs at both the right time and your right time. Opportunity is chance and seizing that chance. It's luck and making that luck. It's turning possibility into probability into actuality. It's turning fantasy into reality. Opportunity is creating options and forging openings, turning chances and choices into changes. Opportunity is a new beginning, a fresh start again and again and again. It's another chance to succeed this time or the next time, at any time. It's seeing a way forward, seeking out a solution, spotting what others are missing, solving where others are struggling. In business, opportunity is an exploitable set of circumstances with uncertain outcome, requiring commitment of resources and involving exposure to risk. This is the Business Dictionary definition. It's about having faith in the infinite unknowns, the limitless, latent potential. It's found in the paradoxical balance of persistence and patience, in risking failure in order to succeed. Opportunity is both a window and a door. Sometimes it opens right in front of you, and sometimes it knocks. But it needs to be seen and to be taken in order to exist. It needs both a decision and a commitment. Opportunity equals freedom. Freedom from being trapped and out of control. Freedom to change, to move out of and away from stagnation, complacency, comfort, and boredom. To embrace the unexpected, the change of plan, the curveball and the blindside. It's a chance to improve, to grow, to learn new things and to do and be better than before. Whether that's personally, in teams, in your family, or for your health, wealth, happiness, and business. Opportunity is about already being ready, putting yourself out there to meet the opportunity, making things happen, not waiting for things to happen, creating your own luck and seizing the day, today, now. By definition, opportunity is a thing, an opening, an event, and you can choose what you do with it. You can see it or miss it, seize it or squander it, let it in or push it away, say no to it or say hell yes to it. When I asked the 20,000 and counting members of my closed private Facebook group, the Disruptive Entrepreneurs Community, what opportunity means to them, their responses were enlightening, and they clearly showed that there's a big element of self-knowledge to opportunity. You need to know yourself and be ready before opportunity will appear, whether it's something that exists already or something new that you create. What you do with an opportunity can become part of its very definition. Can an opportunity be real if you don't engage with it? If you can't see the opportunity, it has no value or meaning, said one person. Taking advantage of a set of circumstances that can give you a positive experience and result, said another person. Some talked about the opportunity existing already, waiting to be seen and grabbed. It's an external factor which, should you shape a course of action towards seizing it, could have a positive outcome. Creating an unexpected but not unwelcome set of events or circumstances. For others, opportunity is something I've made for myself. It's something you create yourself and act on because you see and do what others can't and don't. People talked about opportunity being transient. If you don't take an opportunity, it disappears. Some think opportunity is something everyone sees, but few take action on. Others think it's hidden to most people. For some, opportunity is stronger in adversity. Look at everything in life, especially failure, as an opportunity. That conversely, success can be a poor teacher and that you learn the most from your mistakes. One thing many people agreed on was that taking action is key. When all is said and done, more is said than done. To know and not to do is not to know. When opportunity knocks, as the saying goes, you need to actually open the bloody door to make something happen. You need to wake up, be present, be ready, mentally and physically, to jump in or on at the right time. The American entrepreneur Thomas Edison, arguably history's most persistent action taker, reputedly said, "The reason most people do not recognize an opportunity is because it usually goes around wearing overalls and looking like hard work." I believe there's limitless, infinite opportunity hidden in plain sight. Opportunity in abundance. For me, opportunity is in abundance. The only thing that changed for me in that moment on December the 15th, 2005, was my state of mind. I was desperate, and I finally opened up to the opportunities around me, even if driven by pain. Since then, I've consistently seen that opportunity is everywhere. It is infinite. Hindsight is always 20/20, of course, but if I look back to that day, to my turning point, I see it as a wormhole opening to a new state of being. I pivoted in that moment and turned into a different version of myself. I had opened my mind, or had my mind opened, to new opportunities that I'd never considered existed, that I'd never seen, let alone knew were relevant or available to me. With an open mind, I could imagine myself and my life differently. I could see what was always there, but hadn't been able to see. I was stuck with a vision of myself as a struggling and failing artist, drowning in consumer debt and angry with the world. Vision is such an important aspect of opportunity. We'll be coming back to that later. You have to metaphorically open your eyes to really see what's around you, as well as visualizing opportunities in order to create them. And when you do open your eyes, you'll see that you're surrounded by opportunity. When I asked you at the start of this chapter to think of the last time you had an opportunity, was that moment right now? If not, then you're missing out. You have an opportunity right now. You just haven't seen it, recognized it, or created it yet. That's what this book's going to help you do. Of course, seeing is subjective. You view from your perspective. You're in your own context with your own fears and failings, your own hang-ups and hardships, values and visions. But subjectivity can sometimes block opportunity. You can learn to step back and really see what's around you to spot the opportunities, to see what's actually there, not just what's coming through your opportunity filter. Our opportunity filters are based on our judgments and past experiences, and we shouldn't just blindly trust them. They're so often muddied by years of conditioning, self-doubt, and imposter syndrome, and then sealed by our fears. You can learn to clean those filters and see what was really there all along. Just because you can't see it doesn't mean it isn't there. Then comes the moment to take action, to take that opportunity, to seize the day. And for this, you need to cultivate a can-do attitude. That's often easy at the start. Who hasn't been swept away at the beginning of a project, convinced it'll change everything, that life will be better when? But maintaining momentum once the novelty has worn off and the fantasy becomes reality, this is where the progress and the results show. And for that, you need a grip on your routine, and I'll show you how to get that. But you also need a desire or hunger to succeed, for something bigger than you, something to keep the fire inside you burning when things get hard. For me, at that key moment, it was desperation. I had to make it happen because the alternative was just too painful, and I was ready to do anything to get it done. For so long, I'd been sleepwalking, and finally, I was awake. I was hungry, literally being in £50,000 of consumer debt, and I had a strong desire to change my life. That hunger and desire have to come with a dose of reality, though. You can't say yes to everything. Rose-tinted filters won't help. If you consider every opportunity as a blessing and something to take, or you find it hard to say no, you'll very soon be overwhelmed, drowning, and unfocused. Your priorities will become unclear. You'll overstretch yourself, underperform, fail, let people down, and then you'll beat yourself up over it. I've seen this happen to many people, myself included, and especially entrepreneurs. And I often wrestle with this, finding conflict and letting others down not natural to me. Saying yes became really trendy a few years back. In the British comedian Danny Wallace's book Yes Man, 2005, he writes about a chance encounter with a man on a bus who told him people should say yes more often. He saw this as an opportunity to change his life, and he decided to say yes to everything for a year. Everything. Every offer, every invitation, every question. His adventure made for an hilarious book and an equally hilarious film starring Jim Carrey, and it also kick-started the affirmative, optimistic yes movement. But, as Wallace points out in his book, yes can go wrong. Whether it's in business or dating or health or any part of your life, saying yes too much can create overwhelm, which makes you frustrated, even depressed, and it can lead you to procrastinate and can erode your self-worth because you end up never finishing or achieving anything of any kind of importance. I think there's a paradox in everything, and there's a clear one here. Doing too much leads to achieving nothing at all. All this can make opportunity seem complex and multidimensional, and it can be. Opportunity is within you as much as it is outside of you, and it's just as complex as you are. It's integrally linked to your innermost emotions. You take an opportunity when it feels right. You reject one when it doesn't feel right. We'll dive into how your emotions manifest your opportunities in the next chapter. The key is knowing yourself and adapting yourself and managing your emotions and your filters and your attitudes and your approaches to maximize your opportunities. But it's also simple. It's something you see or something you don't, something you take or something you don't, something you create or something you don't. It's the flip of a coin, a snap decision, a fleeting moment, and there's an infinite number of them. In part one of this book, we'll look more closely at opportunity, what it is and where it is, how it's related to luck and pure potentiality. We'll lay down the foundations you can build on to bring more opportunity into your life. Then get ready to take notes and start practicing and implementing, because remember, when all is said and done, more is said than done. So in part two, we'll look at how to prepare for opportunity, how to adapt and develop yourself and your own life areas in order to create the conditions to let opportunity appear. Then in part three, we'll continue the practical approach and skill you up on spotting, assessing, and taking opportunities. This section contains the practical, tactical advice to help you make real changes, because to know and not to do is not to know. Then roll up your sleeves and get out your calendar, because in part four, I'll guide you through my tried and tested methods for seizing the day, from planning through execution to evaluation and the continued upscaling and upcycling of ever greater opportunities and the gifts they bring into your life. Opportunities never end. But how can seizing the day help you win at life? And what does that even mean anyway? Well, in part five, we'll look more closely at success, progress, and winning at life, helping you change your perspectives and leverage your opportunities in a way that works for you. Then in part six, you'll make commitments and get some accountability for creating opportunities, for seizing the day, and winning at life. Start now and get perfect later. So, are you ready to welcome opportunity into your life? Summary. Opportunity means different things to different people. By definition, opportunity is a thing, an opening, an event, and you can choose what you do with it. You can see it or miss it, seize it or squander it, push it away or let it in, say yes to it or no to it. In this book, you'll learn the habits, skills, and tactics to help you create, spot, and take opportunities to seize the day and win at life. Take action. What does opportunity mean for you? 1. Write down your own definition. 2. Write a list of situations or events in the last week that match that definition. 3. Put a tick or cross next to each one to indicate if you took the opportunity or not. And I'm watching you. We'll come back to this list later. Part 1. Opportunity Knocks. Chapter 1. The Nature of Opportunity. At what point would you say...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.